Very good morning, my dear students, and welcome back to your chemistry class. So as in previous class, you have observed that we have started with the metals and non-metals. There we have studied physical property of metal and physical property of non-metal also. And now you know that which are the metals and which are the non-metals. We can differentiate on the basis of physical property. Yes. So usually metals are ductile, sonorous, and these are malleable. And some of the examples you have observed. And non-metals, some non-metals doesn't have these properties, but non-metals, some of the non-metals like graphite, carbon allotropes, and even you can say gallium and cesium, all these are the non-metals which has some of the properties, so that are considered in the exception cases. So the non-metals, some of the non-metals are there which shows the different property. As you know, in physical property of the metals, all metals are differentiated. In previous class, you have written the differences between the metals and non-metals. You can observe in your point book. So on the basis of that, it is not possible to differentiate the metal and non-metals. So that's why physical property is not enough. It is not enough to differentiate whether it is a metal or the non-metal. For example, any metal is given for you, which you don't know, the two metals they have given, you have to differentiate whether it is a metal or the non-metal. You have to differentiate only by the observation is it possible to differentiate, because we know that in non-metals some are lustrous in nature. For example, iodine, it is a luster in nature. Yes. So that time the metal has the luster property. If you differentiate that one as a metal, then it will be wrong. So that's the reason why the physical properties we can consider. But rather than then, if you go to the chemical property, then it is better to differentiate the metal and non-metal. So after that, what we have studied, chemical properties of metals also we have studied there. And in chemical property of metals, first one, that is what happens when metal burnt with the air. So you know that whenever there is a burnt with air means in presence of oxygen. So any chemical, when it is possible to burn, when there is a presence of oxygen. So that whatever we have studied there, and remember with the examples all the things there. So that much. At the last about reactivity of the hydrogen, reactivity of the potassium, all sodium reactivity, and even why these are kept in kerosene. So these concepts also we have studied, and metal oxides, non-metal oxides, how it reacts also we have studied. After that, the 3.2.2, what happens when metal reacts with water, this concept is skipped. But one thing remember, that they have not mentioned about the experiment. So what we will do, we will practice the concept is not there, but we will practice the diagram for that. And one just to think, remember that when chemical properties of the metal reacts with air, what happens when metal reacts with air means it is oxygen, you will get the metal oxide. So like that, when what happens when metal reacts with water, you should know the concept. Yes. So that's why remember that metal reacts with water. Whenever the metal reacts with water, water means there we have oxygen, O2. Here water means H2O you have. When metal reacts with water, you will get metal oxide plus of hydrogen. So remember, the hydrogen gas is evolved here. And again, if the metal oxide again react with water, we will get the metal hydroxide. Just remember this concept. So it may come any way of your topic, so it is needed for you, but the overall concept we don't need. Just remember that any metal, if they have given, if it is reacted with the water, we will get a metal oxide plus hydrogen. And there when metal reacts with the oxygen, you will get the metal oxide. And when again this metal oxide is reacted with water, you will get a metal hydroxide. Metal hydroxide is nothing but any metal. For example, you can observe sodium reacted with potassium and sodium reacted with the water to give respective of potassium hydroxide and sodium hydroxide. And don't again ask that, ma'am, you told potassium and sodium are highly reactive with water. If you dissolve that one, if you react that one with the water, then it will give the metal hydroxide. As I told, these catches fire when you react with the water, these catches fire. Then why we are doing this one? So there are certain condition on that we will not add the cold water here. We are using the hot waters. So when it is when reaction is taking, certain conditions we will follow. So due to that, they have given heat energy. That means it is an exothermic reaction. And remember here also, exothermic reaction and endothermic. Exothermic means heat liberated. Endothermic means absorption of the heat. So that's, you have to practice for the diagram. And remember what happens when metal reacts with water. Whenever the metal reacts with water, we will get a metal oxide plus hydrogen, and some of the examples you have to remember there. Okay, next concept, what happens when metal reacts with acid. So this concept is there for us. So what happens when metal reacts with acids? So acid, as you know, so you have to know some of the acid name. Yes, HCl, HNO3. So you have to remember all those things. And okay, so we will study about this, what happens when metal react with acid. So first thing is, whenever whatever it may be the metal, if the metal reacts with acid, you will get salt plus of hydrogen. So metal reacts with a dilute acid to give salt plus hydrogen. Now we can study some of the examples. So metal, now whichever the metals you will consider, that you have to react with any acid. So we will consider HCl here, and as they have given, check with the magnesium. Magnesium is the metal, aluminium is the metal, and iron, and another one, zinc, we will consider. So there are the four metals which we have considered, and we will react these metals with dilute HCl. So HCl, HCl, and HCl, you have to form the product. Now so we know that metal reacts with dilute acid to give a salt. So salt means, as it is the positive term, it react with a negative term, and it will remain as it is. That means we want hydrogen here. So this is confirmed, we will get at the final H2. This is confirmed for every reaction. And you have to form a salt now. So H is removed, means remaining is MgCl, and here AlCl, here FeCl, and here ZincCl. But you have to now you have to balance the equation. And Mg, you know that Mg is always plus 2. So I have taught you in a previous class how to write Mg is plus 2, and chlorine is Cl minus. So now you have to write the reaction of these two, means cross multiply. So Mg, as it is a minus 1, it will come 1. Cl, this will come as 2. So MgCl2 is the magnesium chloride formula. So MgCl2. Now you can observe that the Cl2, whether it is a balanced equation, no, because Cl is 2 here, Cl is 1 here. That means you have to balance this one. If it is 2Cl2, this is okay, 2 hydrogen, this is okay, magnesium is 1, magnesium is 1. So this is our first example, we can say. After that, aluminium reacts with HCl, hydrochloric acid, which is the acid. It will give the aluminium chloride. So aluminium chloride, aluminium is plus 3, Al plus 3, and chlorine is Cl minus. So you have to write the compound name Al, cross multiply these things. So AlCl3, as it is a 1, no need to mention A1Cl3, that is AlCl3. So AlCl3. Now whether the equation is balanced, no, because Cl is 1, Cl is 3 here. So I have to balance the Cl first, so I will make here as 3. If it is 3, then it will become 3 hydrogen. So is it possible to do anything here? No. Then if I add 3 here, 3 2s are 6, it will become. So I will make this one as a 6. If it is 6, 3 2s I will add, 3 2s are 6. Now it is okay. So this is 6, okay. And 6HCl. So 3 2s are 6. Hydrogen is okay. Chlorine is 3 2s are 6. 3 2s are 6. But observe the aluminium, it is 2Al. That means you have to add. Now equation is balanced. Third one, as iron is the metal, when it reacts with HCl, it will give FeCl. So FeCl, as it is plus 2 and minus 1, so it is Fe1Cl2. Okay, then H2, you can observe Fe is 1, okay, Cl is 2, so you have to add 2 here, 2Cl, okay, balance it, 2H, H2, so it is balanced. Now zinc chloride, zinc plus HCl, zinc chloride, so Zn is 1, Cl is 1, Cl is 1, Zn is also plus 1 and Cl is also minus 1, so plus 1 minus 1, Zn Cl. Hydrogen is 1 here, but here it is 2, so you have to balance this one. 2 into 2, H2 is 2. Then what about Cl then? You have to balance the Cl as also then. 2 into Cl, that is 2. Now the zinc exceeds here, 2 into Z, so Zn, so it is 2. Now the equation is balanced. So now here you can observe that the acid I have used only HCl here. Then what about another, that is HNO3. When you do this reaction, when the metal reacts with HNO3, that is your nitric acid, even you can write as nitric acid. So it will not form a salt, it will not form a salt plus hydrogen, because there is a reason that this HNO3 is a oxidizing agent. You have studied this one in first unit. What do you mean by the oxidizing agent? Oxidizing agent means it will add oxygen to the compound. So what actually the our concept, whenever the metal reacts with HCl, it will form a metal salt with that hydrogen. So when HNO3 is acting as an oxidizing agent, that means it will add oxygen to the compound, means with the metal salt it will form water compound. So what, as hydrogen is there, as it is oxidizing, it will add oxygen, then there is a formation of H2O molecule. Yes, so that's why if with HNO3 the reaction is not possible. So here some of the point you can include: the metals does not react with HNO3, that is nitric acid, to form salt and water. So we have to give reason for this, why HNO3 is not acting, why HNO3 is oxidizing agent, all things we have to mention here. As metal reacts with HNO3, there is no formation of salt because the HNO3 is a oxidizing agent. Even you can write Z also here, okay, oxidizing agent. HNO3 is oxidizing agent, that means adding of hydrogen, you have studied that one, addition of oxygen. So due to that, what changes you can observe as metal reacts with acid, we will get a salt plus hydrogen. As if HNO3 is the acid, as it is the oxidizing agent, it will add oxygen to the hydrogen atom. So that time there is a formation of water molecule. So there is a formation of water, or we can write reason, because strong oxidizing agent HNO3, the produced hydrogen gas, will write here only, it will convert to water. So now it is enough, but there are some of the exception cases also are there. Even HNO3 is a strong oxidizing agent, the magnesium and manganese, so these are the two metals, so you know that magnesium and manganese are the metals. Even these can react with HNO3 to produce magnesium nitrate, which is a salt, plus of hydrogen. So these are the two exception elements. Remember magnesium and manganese. So we'll write the example of these also. We have exception cases where metals like magnesium and manganese reacts with HNO3 to produce salt plus of hydrogen. So magnesium plus of HNO3 will give magnesium nitrate. So magnesium is plus 2, okay? If it is a plus 2, NO3 twice you have to write. Then this is H2 means it is 2. So HNO3 2. Now equation is balanced. Okay, 3 2s are 6. Then another one is Mn. Mn reacts with HNO3 to give MnNO3. So as it is also Mn also plus 2, it is 2. Then H2. So H2 means it is 2, 2, 3 2s are 6. So it is 6. Mn is 1, Mn is 1. So these are the two exception cases. So here you have to remember, any metal reacts with HCl, you will get the salt plus of hydrogen. But in case of HNO3, it is not possible to form a salt because HNO3 is a oxidizing agent. Oxidizing agent means addition of the oxygen, or you can say that removal of hydrogen in another cases. But here we can observe only it is adding the oxygen to the hydrogen. So whenever there is a adding of oxygen to the hydrogen, there is a formation of water. So that time we can't say that the reaction we are getting as the salt plus of hydrogen. So as we have written the reason, as it is oxidizing agent, the produced H2 gas will convert to the water. And even though this is the rare condition, we can observe that in magnesium and manganese, even the HNO3 is a oxidizing agent, but also there is a formation of a salt plus hydrogen. Which are those examples? That is magnesium and manganese. Okay, another important concept here, you have to study about the aqua-regia solution. So aqua-regia solution is the mixture of HCl and HNO3. So HCl and HNO3 we are taking in the ratio, that is 3:1. 3:1 is nothing but hydrochloric acid is 3 and 1% of nitric acid. That means if you are taking any solution, if you want to make the aqua-regia solution, means 3%, that means 3 ml of HCl acid you are taking, then 1% of HNO3 acid you are taking, that for the aqua regia. If you are taking 3 liters, means 3 liters of HCl and 1 liter of concentrated nitric acid. So like that the aqua regia solution is prepared. Then why it is needed? The aqua regia solution is, you can observe that we know that HNO3 is a stronger oxidizing agent and HCl is also a stronger acid. But when you add these, there is a formation of a liquid which is very corrosive, and even you can observe there is a fuming means the fumes it will create, and it has the capacity, it will become a reagent means which helps to make the reaction properly. So this reagent can able to dissolve the metals like gold and platinum. So these are very helpful for us. So the aqua regia solution usually we are using in the laboratory. So just remember that, what do you mean by the aqua regia? So for that you can write one sentence. Now the mixture of hydrochloric acid and concentrated nitric acid in the ratio of 3:1, which is called as a aqua regia solution. And don't make the mistakes, 3, that is HCl quantity will be more than the nitric acid, because as it is the stronger, nitric acid is a stronger oxidizing agent, so the value must be less compared to the HCl. So 3:1, so HCl is 3 and nitric acid is a 1. So write down that definition, then we will move towards our next concept. So you can continue the points, write it as a note, aqua regia solution, and there you write the definition and what is the major quantity, what is the major quality of that aqueous is a solution. So after that, so how the metal reacts with a solution of other metal salt. So this concept is not there, but we have studied this one in our first unit also. But as it is related to the next topic, so just we will observe what it says exactly. How the metal reacts the solution of other metal salt. So for example, so as they have given, metal reacts with another metal salt. For example, you just consider an example of one metal which is react with a metal salt. So what is the product you can get, they have asked. So for that, you can remember your first unit example, that is iron, where you know iron nail we have kept immersed in the copper sulfate solution. So that time what you have observed, the iron and copper get displaced, so that is FeSO4, the solution we will get FeSO4 plus or copper, any metal. So roughly example, okay, don't consider this one as an exact example. So here the displacement, double displacement reaction, the metals are getting exchanged to each other. So such concept we have studied. So that only applied here, the how the metals reacts with the solution of other metal salt. What they have did, they have considered the metal A, salt of the solution B and salt of solution A. That means the metal A reacts with another part, and the one of the metal is displaced, that is metal A is displaced by the metal B. So this you have studied, displacement reaction, double displacement reaction. Yes, so there you can observe that here what they have given, one is the copper sulfate solution iron nail and copper wire and iron sulfate solution. So there is iron sulfate solution, copper sulfate solution. So now we will observe. So the observation we will write. Observation, what they have given, in one case we have iron plus copper sulfate solution, and in another case we have copper and iron sulfate solution, and there is a reaction formed there. And the reaction we can observe that at the first test tube there is a changes, because there is a displacement will takes place, and there is a formation of iron sulfate plus of copper. But if you observe copper and iron sulfate, there is no reaction we can observe. This is because the iron is more reactive compared to the copper. That time what will happen, more reactive, what it means, the iron is more reactive, so which can easily displaces the metal. So if it is a less reactive, if it is a more reactive, the more reactive element will displaces the less reactive element metal. So that's the reason why iron displaces the copper easily, and copper deattached from its sulfate as it is more reactive. The iron is more reactive compared to the copper. So this concept what we have studied, and we know that is applied on the basis of reactive metal series. So reactive metal series is the arrangement. So have the scientists have arranged the reactive metals. So metals they have observed, and they have did the experiment. On the basis of that, they have arranged the series, and this is the one of the most important concept of this topic. So study properly the reactive series. That's the reason why they have left this concept, and they have kept this one, because if you understand this one, then it is easy to understand the reactive series. So first thing, you have to know this table. So which is the more reactive, which is the less reactive. You can observe the potassium, sodium, calcium, manganese, these are the more reactive compared to the gold. You know that the gold and silver, mercury, it will not react easily. So if it reacts, means as you know, gold, we can gold jewelries we are making, we are preparing those things. Yes, so if it is more reactive, means then what it may happen, reactive means it will react with oxygen, hydrogen, other chemicals. If it is more reactive, means it is not possible to prepare the jewelries. So that's why these are less reactive, and if you observe at the top, it is more reactive. So you have to remember this reactivity table. Okay, so for that you can use some of the mnemonics to understand. So one of the mnemonics, how to remember this one, I will tell you. And After that, we will move towards the concept. So you can remember by any method, okay? So if it is possible to remember, like potassium, sodium, calcium, magnesium, you can remember. But easiest way how to remember, first thing is, as must and should know the name of the some of the elements. So sodium, potassium is K, sodium is Na, calcium is Ca, magnesium, aluminium is Al, zinc is Zn, Fe, lead is Fb, hydrogen, copper, mercury is Hg, and Ag and Au. So here you can observe that the potassium, so that's why I have given the mnemonics as, please stop calling me Algebra, I like her to call a smart girl. Okay, so here it will easy that P, so P means it is potassium. So potassium, so we know that the chemical symbol K, and stop means sodium. So sodium symbol is Na, calling. C means calcium, so calcium is A, me, M, first letters you have to observe. Magnesium, that is Mg. A means aluminium, Al, and Gibra. Z means it is zinc, so Zn, iron, Fe. So first letter you have to observe, L, so it is lead, so it is Pb. You have to remember the things. H means hydrogen, so it is H. Let's make this one as a capital. And call, I like her, you can add any sentence to call. C means it is copper, remember here calcium and here copper, that is U. And smart, S means silver, and G means gold. Silver is Ag and gold is Au. So this is the mnemonics you can use how to remember the reactive table. And reactive, as come to the downwards, it is less reactive. Reactivity decreases, less reactive. These are the more reactive. Okay. So this is about reactive table. That means if you have any two metals, so like sodium and calcium. So if sodium reacts with any other sulfate reaction, any other metal sulfate reaction, so on the basis of reactive, as which one is the more reactive, that one first displaces the salt of the compound. So that you will study here. So what it exactly means, so you can observe, as we have studied iron sulfate and copper sulfate. So here observe that iron is here, and what about copper is here. Yes, so in our book only we will make those things. So where is the iron? Fe. So you can observe Fe is here, iron is here, and copper is here. Yes, so which is the more reactive here? As it is the upwards, which one is the first, that is more reactive. So iron is more reactive compared to copper. So if it is more reactive, whenever the iron and copper sulfate solution you are making, now you can observe that this is the metal and this is the metal salt. Yes, so metal salt. So metal reacts with metal salt to give another salt, metal salt. So here there is a displacement on the basis, whether the copper displaces the iron or iron displaces the copper, the question arises. So the on the basis of reactivity table, which one is more reactive? Iron is more reactive. If iron is a more reactive, then iron displaces the copper easily. If it is copper, then it is not possible, because copper is less reactive compared to the iron. Yes, so it is FeSO4. So like that, every example, if you consider calcium and copper, then calcium is more reactive. If you consider silver and zinc, so zinc is more reactive. If you consider iron and hydrogen, the iron is more reactive. So like that it will happen. If the question they have asked, like another one we will consider, sodium and iron we will consider. So sodium is Na and iron is FeSO4. So here sodium is more reactive than Fe, so it will displaces the Fe from the experiment. So Na to SO4 it will come, plus of Fe. So it displaces, the sodium displaces the iron. But if the question is FeSO4 plus of sodium, then it is not possible. It is not possible because give reason that as iron is less reactive compared to the sodium, it is not possible to displace. It will not dominate that one. So which is the more reactive, that will displaces the another element. So this is about your reactive series. So study the reactive series properly and try to remember the reactive series. From this, so many questions may arises. If you have any doubt, you can ask with me. So even there is one question they have given on that basis. Samples of four metals A, B, C, D were taken and added to the following solution. The result obtained is tabulated. So metal A, B, C, D. So they have given four metals and there you can observe that iron sulfate, copper sulfate. So metals react with metal salt. Metals reacts with metal salt to give the reaction. So there is no reaction means there is no displacement. There is a reaction means there is a displacement. When the displacement is there, when there is a more reactive substance is there, more reactive metal is there, that time there is a displacement. So where there is no reaction, that means the metal, whichever the metal they have used, that is less reactive compared to the these metal sulfates. So use the table, answer the following questions about A, B, C, D. Which is the most reactive metal? So first you can observe metal A. Metal A, there is no reaction, there is displacement, there is no MTS. So where there is a displacement, there is a reactivity. There is a reactivity and it is a more reactive. That metal is more reactive. And here you can observe there is no displacement. Which is the most reactive then? So here you can observe B, there is a displacement. So as there is a displacement at iron sulfate, at the first solution there is a displacement means it is more reactive. So we can say that the metal B is more reactive here. And after that second, what would you observe if B is added to the solution of copper 2 sulfate? So copper 2, B is added to the copper 2 sulfate. So as you know, B is more reactive at iron sulfate. And iron sulfate in the series table, iron is here and copper is here. So that means copper is less reactive than the iron. So if metal B displaces the iron, more reactive substance, then what you can observe here? Whether it again displaces the salt or not. So what we can say here, yes, definitely it will displaces, because at the first iron sulfate only it displaces, means the less reactive substances also it can replace. And third one, arrange the metal A, B, C, D in the order of decreasing activity. First thing we know that the B is more reactive, as it at the first case only it displaces. And after that observe, now we want A, C, D. In this, which one is the more reactive? You can observe at copper sulfate solution, copper is, iron is more reactive. After that, copper is more reactive compared to the other. So here there is a displacement reaction. So if it is a displacement, then A is a more reactive. And if it is a more, A is a more reactive, then the remaining C and D. Then C and D, you can observe at C, D, there is C, there is a displacement, and D, there is no displacement we have observed. That means C is more reactive compared to the D. So this is thing. In next class also I will explain and I will continue the remaining concept in next class. So just write down the points whatever we have discussed, and if you have any doubt you can contact with me.